Good day, ladies and gentlemen, and everyone in between. So, for some reason, my capture card did not record my microphone audio for this last session of Pokémon Red, meaning I have all the gaming footage from the session, but none of my commentary, which isn't extremely annoying at all. So instead of trying to remember or improv everything I said during that session, I'm just gonna give you an abridged rundown of what happened and what this part of the game is about. Think of it as a practice run for my retrospective later. We will return to our regularly scheduled program next time. After getting my Pokemon's nicknames changed and leaving Lavender Town, the next new area to explore is Route 8. Trainers here are an eclectic assortment of lasses, gamblers, and nerds, and this is the first area where you can catch Growlithe. I caught one not only for Pokedex reasons, but because it's essential to one of my goals for the playthrough. On the far end of the route, just before the gatehouse, a group of lasses and nerds stand in a staggered line ready to battle you. Turns out they're students from Celadon City who are trapped on Route 8 because Celadon City is on lockdown because of Team Rocket. This issue has been going on for a while, it seems. Since the way the Celadon is blocked, you have to take another underground tunnel to get to Route 7. There's nothing special there, it's just a patch of grass in case you didn't catch a Growlithe before. From Route 7, you arrive at Celadon City, the second largest city in the Kanto region. Here, you'll find the Celadon Mansion, the Celadon Department Store, the Game Corner, and of course, the Celadon Gym. The first point of interest for me was the Celadon Mansion. In the front of the building, you can have a meta encounter with the Game Freak team. If you bring them a completed Pokedex, they'll give you a diploma. But if you go to the back entrance of the mansion and go to the top floor, you'll find a Pokeball on a table in some teacher guy's room. And what is in the Pokeball? It's Mother Lovin' Eevee! The greatest Pokemon ever made! Sorry, Eevee is my favorite Pokemon of all time. Once I got Eevee, it was time to check something else off my list. See, there's a glitch in Gen 1 where certain Pokemon have the same kind of effect coding as the elemental stones. Growlithe is one of them. So if you get enough experience points built up, have Eevee start a battle, and then have Growlithe finish the battle, this happens. That's right, free Jolteon, no Thunderstone needed. Growlithe has the same coating as a Thunderstone. I cannot tell you how surprised I was the first time this happened to me during my first playthrough of Red Version. There I was, grinding for levels, when all of a sudden my Eevee turned into a Jolteon. I was like, what the hell, where did this come from? Not Jolteon, I hate Jolteon! Sorry, hate's a strong word. Jolteon is just my least favorite Eeveelution. So of course, when I was done demonstrated that, I loaded my save. Thanks, Growlithe, you served your purpose. I'm gonna keep Eevee as Eevee until it's time to fight Koga. Once the glitch had been demonstrated, I made my way to the Celadon City Gym. You have to use Cut to get there. It's another gym because it's basically a giant habitat exhibit. This gym's theme is grass type, so my party consisted of Butterfree, Beedrill, Parasect, Nidorino, Eevee, and Wartortle. In hindsight, I probably should have put Duglett on the team. It would have really helped me against the Bellsprouts. The first thing you'll notice when you get to the gym is that some old guy is peering into the window. This gym is great. It's full of women. Classy. Very classy. And when you go into the gym, you'll notice the guy who usually gives you pointers on how to take on the leader seems to be absent. Interesting. There are 7 gym traders in total to battle here, all some variety of female NPC. And some of them have some kind of hostile dialogue towards the player. You're not allowed in here! They're in a kind of protective formation around Erica, too, with 2 at the front and the side, and 3 next to her with 3 cuttable bushes that you need to take care of before you can get to her. One of the trainers even mistakes you for the old guy outside of the gym before you battle, and when you beat her, she apologizes for the mistake and says they get a lot of those kinds of people. Oh dear God! So this gym of only women are constantly on the alert, serving as some kind of honor guard for Erica, ready to fight at the first sign of trouble. I guess they're just used to being harassed and stalked by creepy dudes. This is very upsetting. It doesn't help that Erica seems to be lost in her own world. When you talk to her, she just woke up from a nap. Like, Erica, your honor guard is out here busting their butts to keep you safe from your stalkers, and you're snoring? Erica is no joke when it comes to her battle, though. The trainers in the gym all have some flavor of status effect strategy for their battles, but the pattern I ran into the most was them combining Rap with Poison Powder. Rap itself is not a powerful move, but it immobilizes your Pokemon for up to 5 turns. So the combo of that plus poison chipping away away at their health can be pretty effective. You can bypass it by switching your Pokemon out, but the NPCs tended to just do it again. I found myself in a couple of situations where multiple Pokemon were poisoned and the rap damage was rapidly being distributed among them. Erica does something similar, but on steroids. Her victory bell is surprisingly fast, with a speed of 70, and its base attack is 105, so even its rap packs a punch and it lasts a while. It's fairly tanky too, with a defense of 65, so it took quite a few hits before it finally went down. I ended up spreading its damage around a bunch of my Pokemon because it wouldn't stop using poison powder and rap, and it was faster than everyone. I actually had to sacrifice my Nidorino so Parasect could stay in the fight. The next was Tangela, which is arguably the easiest opponent on her team. It just used Constrict the whole time, which is like rap but worse because the target can still move. The last member of her party is Vileplume, who normally would be considered the powerhouse, but on this run, Vileplume just used Petal Dance. This move lasts 2 to 3 turns and leaves the user confused. Being the badass that it is, Parasect was able to tank the hits due to its resistance to grass and siphoned off Vileplume's health in 3 turns thanks to Leech Life. And that's that! Erica graciously accepted the defeat and gave me the Rainbow Badge. According to her, the Rainbow Badge gives you control over Pokemon up to level 50 and lets you use strength outside of battle, but that won't come into play until later. She also gives you the TM for Mega Drain. Now that's going to a certain stinkweed I know. And that's Celadon City. Well, almost. There's still the game corner to do, but I'll take that on in the next video. Bye!